This is Steve Erickson. It's March 17th, 2012, and I'm with Bob Hurt, Tampa, Florida. And we're talking about adverse possession. My purpose for asking more about it is because of the corporations and banks, the international jackasses that have taken over this country. It seems like they can just print up paper, take whatever property they want, and if there's a tool that we the people can use as far as taking possession of some of these properties, I mean legally, go through courts and do it the right way, I would be all ears in hearing how to do it. Go ahead.
Right. You want me to talk?
Yeah.
All right, so first of all, there's a big question as to what adverse possession even is. A lot of people don't know what it is or what it means. And it's probably a good idea just to get this definition of it out of the way first. I could go to a Black's Law Dictionary, but I'll tell you what I'm going to do is use Wikipedia. Because Wikipedia has got to be pretty good about this. And let me look at it real quick.
Okay.
Just type in adverse possession in Wikipedia and they give you a nice definition. But it's got nuances to it that really justify paying close attention. Adverse possession.
Yep.
Is when it occurs, it begins when someone takes possession of somebody else's property. We're specifically talking about real estate now, although it could deal with other property too. On the basis that if somebody is not paying attention to his property, and if he isn't putting it to its highest best use, and he's letting it get run down and become a danger to a community, then all of these justify a government position that would encourage somebody else to go in and get that property and take care of it, even if they have to squat on it to do it. So this has its roots many years, 600 years back in English law, and in general it is considered today that adverse possession by the legal community considers that it is a means of resolving title disputes. But from the common law and statutory law heritage of England, it isn't just for such disputes. It also deals with the way for the king to get his taxes on that property.
Yep.
And to get more than his taxes, to have that property be in as many ways as possible a credit to the community. Because the king and the whole community benefit, and when the community benefits, they're happy with the king. Well, as you know, in America, the people are the sovereigns. They yield a degree of their sovereignty to various levels of government so that the government can give them mutual defense and protection of their rights, prevent injustice, and make it possible for everybody to live with as much liberty as they can to the extent of injuring somebody else, just below that extent. So in the old days, the king turned a blind eye to someone taking over someone else's property. And especially if that someone else didn't come along and say, hey, get off my land. They didn't call the sheriff and say, get this guy off my property.
Yep, trespassing. Yep.
So that idea of trespass, it generally comes from the concept that a person has no right to go and use the rights of someone else without permission. But that implies that the person who would give the permission could also just turn a blind eye, not give permission, but simply abandon the property available for whoever wants to come take it over.
Sorry to interrupt, but if you turn your volume down on your speakers, I won't get the echo on this end. But go ahead. Sorry to interrupt.
Oh, well, okay. Sorry about your echo.
No problem.
Hang on a second.
You were on the roll, too.
D Do you hear me okay?
I hear you perfectly.
Any whistling or noise?
No whistling or noise.
Okay, so the issue here then is this. Adverse possession is a process by which premises can change ownership. It's a common law concept related concerning the title to real property and to the fixed structures built on it. By adverse possession, title to another's real property can be acquired without compensation by holding the property in a manner that conflicts with the true owner's rights for a specified period. Squatter's rights are a specific form of adverse possession. The circumstances in which adverse possession arises determine the type of title acquired by the decisor, the one who obtains the title from the original owner, which may be fee simple title, mineral rights, or other interest in real property. Adverse possession's origins are based both in statutory actions and in common law precepts. So the details concerning adverse possession actions vary by jurisdiction. The required period of uninterrupted possession is governed by the statute of limitations, and other elements of adverse possession are judicial constructs. Now, in general, a person has to take notorious, which means in everybody's face, not hiding it, hostile, that means without the owner's permission, continuous, that means for a specified period of time, uninterrupted, possession of somebody's property for a statutory period of time, and during this time, you know, until the statute of the limitations expires, the owner can come and tell the person to get off his property, and if he doesn't, he's trespassing. But at the end of this time, the person who's sitting on the property as the adverse possessor completes or perfects possessory dominion in the respect that it becomes unfettered by the interest of any other person, that the government cannot come along and move somebody off of it, and the owner cannot come along and say, hey, get off my land anymore. Now, the land still belongs to the owner, but the owner does no longer have a right to tell the adverse possessor to get off, and if the owner sells the property, it goes along with the adverse possessor's rights.
And the adverse possessor can get, if there's any improvements on the property, could possibly get reimbursed, etc.
Well, there have to be improvements made, or it has to be boundaried off so that it's clear what property the person's taken adverse possession of. But in any way you look at it, the bottom line is the adverse possessor is under risk for the entire time that up until the tolling or the ending of the statute of limitations. At the end of the statute of limitations, he can then keep the property without anybody telling him to get off. Now, during the period of adverse possession, the adverse possessor has to pay the taxes and any other government costs, and also discharge any liens that are due. He'd have to pay homeowners association dues if there are any. So that's the idea of adverse possession. Now, the reason adverse possession has come to people's attention is that states like Florida have over a million and a half properties that are residences that are, you know, empty and vacant.
Yes.
So across the United States, you have tens of millions of these properties that are vacant, and a lot of it is because of foreclosure. Part of it is because of the downturn in the real estate market. But whether you have so many places vacant, a lot of them came as foreclosures. Your questions are going to come up, like, where are all these people living now?
Well, in boxes and on the streets, under bridges.
Out in the wild, or some of them live under bridges or in tent cities, cheap motels. They live with friends, and some of them may squat in other houses. So these people have to go somewhere. Now, anybody that is looking at the sense of justice and fairness and all this would realize that, first of all, these people ought to be able to have affordable housing available. And the second thing is that there is housing available. And the third thing is that if people have been going through foreclosure and have abandoned their real estate, then the abandonment of that real estate leaves it open to vandals and others who would not just go squat in it, but who would steal the pieces out of it. A lot of places in Florida have had their air conditioners stolen. Well, that's $5,000 a pop.
Yeah, the copper and pipes, everything, yeah.
It would cost a lot to rehab these places. So your bottom line is that adverse possession looks like it could be a practical solution to the vast unavailability of affordable housing for people. So naturally, people consider, let's do adverse possession of a piece of foreclosure realty that the owner has abandoned. Well, that presents certain dangers, and there are drawbacks to it. To begin with, every mortgage security instrument has a provision in it that if the owner abandons the property, the mortgagee has the right to come in and put it under lock and drain the water pipes and, you know, make it a safe place so that it won't get further deteriorated and destroyed. And sometimes they send preservers or conservators into the property, but those conservators are sometimes convicted felons working for a job for some, you know, reservation company, and they'll enter the property and just steal stuff from it, taking laptops, jewelry, or whatever they find laying around.
Hey, I used to do that, and I wasn't a convicted felon. I would work for banks.
Pardon?
I said I used to do that kind of work for banks, and I would I had a good reputation, so they'd have me do that. So the banks I used to work for, I used to go and I'd secure places, do whatever painting, whatever else, and that they would be auctioned off or whatever, or put on the on the market real estate. So
all right, so this another problem with the adverse possession of foreclosure abandoned realty lies in the fact that the person that takes this property, unless he's a complete idiot, he knows that eventually the foreclosure plaintiff is going to come take that property. He's going to, the court or the, in the case of a non-judicial foreclosure state, the trustee is going to order the auctioning of the property so that the money received from the auction can pay off the debt. And that auctioning process, in order to even make sure the house is worthy of being auctioned off as a decent condition, or regardless of whether it's worthy or not, in order to see what it's worth, they may make it open to the public or put a lockbox on it so realtors can show it or what. But the point is, at the point in time they decide they want to do that, if there's an adverse possessor living in the place, they're going to tell him to get out. And if he doesn't get out, the sheriff can arrest him for trespass.
Yep.
Now, there are two ways to get them out. One is just tell the sheriff, and the sheriff will arrest them for trespass. And the other is come at them with a writ of ejectment or a writ of possession or an unlawful detainer. But, you know, when a person who's an adverse possessor gets such an order from a court, he needs to get out of the property and you know, not stay there any longer.
Uh-huh.
Well, this brings up the question of, if he knew in advance he's likely going to have to leave,
yep,
because most foreclosers
yep
are not going to let the property get, you know, lay fallow for 7 years in Florida,
yep,
years, so a person can consummate his, fulfill his adverse possession. They're going to come foreclose the property and force a foreclosure auction before that happens. So it's disingenuous for a person to think that he could take adverse possession of a foreclosure abandoned realty and actually fulfill the adverse possession statute of limitations. Therefore, it's, I guess you'd say, fraudulent or it's dishonest to think one could do it. But nevertheless, the law does not deal with that. The law is pretty interesting on this subject. And as you have heard in this article, which I didn't read all of, you can go in and read it.
Yeah.
This article that deals with adverse possession of Wikipedia it tells us point blank that adverse possession is a part of the English and a common and statutory law that stretches back for hundreds and hundreds of years.
English common law.
All the way back, if you may think, to 1066, to the greatest adverse possessor of modern times, and I guess you could say 1066 is relatively modern, when William the Conqueror came over from Normandy, killed the English king and his nephew and his son, and they just stole England. He took adverse possession of it. And that has happened a lot on this planet. So we may not like it, but might does make right, and the government enforces the principle that might makes right. The government puts its might behind people who would take adverse possession if they fulfill the statute of limitations. Now, I want to make this even clearer by reading a couple of statutes that are out of the Florida statutes that make this point with crystal clarity. In Florida, in 1829, the legislature passed one of its first laws, and it's in Chapter 2, it's Section 2.01, and it says, common law and certain statutes declared in force. The common and statute laws of England, which are of a general and not a local nature, with the exception hereinafter mentioned, down to the fourth day of July, 1776, are declared to be of force in this state, provided the said statutes and common law be not inconsistent with the Constitution and laws of the United States and the acts of the legislature of this state. So, notice that the English law of Florida was put into place in 1829, and it was the English and statutory common law and statutory law up till the 4th of July, 1776, Independence Day.
Yep.
And it has remained in force except as the legislature of Florida or the Constitution and laws of the United States have outlawed it. Now, there was a provision in English common law in 1776, which changed, I believe, 13 years later.
Yep.
And that provision was called wager of battle. And it was a method by which people could settle disputes in physical contests against one another, which would be swords or knives or guns or arm wrestling or tiddlywinks or whatever they wanted to use.
Well, there you go.
Now, the question is, since that was part of the English law, was it inconsistent with the Constitution or the laws of the United States or the laws of the state of Florida? If it wasn't inconsistent, then it's still enforced today. Now, in 1973, the Supreme Court of Florida ruled in a very interesting decision that the Supreme Court, two decisions. The first decision, they said that that the legislature cannot make a statute that removes a common law right without providing a suitable statutory substitute. And later the Supreme Court said that even though the legislature can't change the common law, the Supreme Court can, because the Supreme Court is the source of the common law, and they can change it as the needs of society, the changes of civilization warrant it. So we have the Supreme Court presuming a lot of power upon itself, maybe wrongly, and taking away the legislature's authority to change, to eliminate English common law. This is critically important, because if adverse possession was a right throughout the history of England for several hundred years prior to Independence Day, and certainly it's still enforced today, then if there's nothing in the Florida law that makes it not a right, well, guess what? It's still a right. It's not merely a remedy, it's a right. It is a right for people to go in and take over ignored, abandoned, unutilized real estate if the owner doesn't protest against it. And that's all there is to it. I mean, it's not hard to understand this. People may hate it and think, damn it, I worked all my life to get enough money. That farm's been in my family for 100 years. Well, it doesn't matter. If you ignore a corner of your farm and somebody takes adverse possession of it, starts, you know, breeding animals or raising crops on it, too bad for you if the statute of limitations expires. And I'll give you an example. A guy told me the other day that he bought a piece of land 20 years ago and hadn't been over to it in 15 years. Well, in that period of time, somebody could have declared adverse possession of part of it or even all of it. And if he's been asleep at the wheel, he doesn't even know it. And if he goes out there, he might see a nice big farmhouse on it, and they're going to look at him and say, too bad for you. You were asleep at the wheel. You ignored your property and ignored your rights and your obligations because you have obligations. Now, it may be he was paying taxes. See, that brings us to another issue, this taxation thing. Taxes work. Property taxes work in Florida this way. The Florida law provides that a county tax collector can auction off the tax liens if the property the taxes haven't been paid on the property. They have a certain period of time within which they do this, and that means if the owner hasn't paid the taxes, obviously he's not paying attention. So what the state does, I mean not the state, but the tax collector for the county, is he auctions these tax liens off. Whoever wins the bid and buy the tax lien, and then the third year thereafter, the person who owns the tax lien can then demand payment of the tax from the owner of the property. And if the owner doesn't pay it, he can foreclose on the property and force a foreclosure tax lien, tax deed sale to get paid his tax and whatever interest it's accrued back. So if a person does this for 2 or 3 years, in the third year, he can auction off or force a foreclosure of the first year, and he might just be able to buy the property for the taxes alone. So anybody that does adverse possession is advised, or seems to me it would be sensible for such a person to try to buy the tax liens on the property, because that's the ideal way of paying the taxes. Because if you pay the taxes by simply paying them, the state of Florida will return the taxes to anybody who pays them other than the owner or the owner's agent, such as a mortgagee.
Well, there you go.
So this payment of taxes provides opportunities to people who want to do adverse possession to get another, say, thumb in the pie, so to speak, by being able to force a foreclosure sale based on a tax lien certificate. Okay, so now we have dealt with the taxes issue. Let's deal with the biggest problem that adverse possessors have, and that is the government interfering with it. Typically, the sheriffs have announced in Texas that they just arrested 6 people for squatting. They may have been doing adverse possession, and in Jacksonville, police just had a report on the other day on the news that that the police arrested 4 people for squatting, and they never even bothered to take an adverse possession nor filed any papers. But in Florida, you see, you could call yourself a squatter or whatever you wish and take over the property as long as you pay the taxes and improve it. What'll happen is you can become an adverse possessor because you have a whole year after taking physical possession to file your notice of adverse possession.
It's banks, can be international. The town hall, people that work at town hall, lawyers, the government, they can take adverse possession, and there's nothing thought bad of them. When I lived in Stafford Springs, Connecticut, the selectman for the town, he was a lawyer, John Julian. He would ask his neighbor if he could hunt on his yard for a period of time. There was a well that was over on the side. So what John Julian did is he said that his neighbor had banded part of his property. So he took a major portion of his neighbor's property because he allowed him to hunt on it, saying that he wasn't caring for it. He said he cared for the grounds and all that. So he took it. And he also got a free well out of the deal. And I don't know whether he charged his neighbor for water from the well or not after he took possession of his neighbor's property. But that was a sleazy example of adverse possession that I'm aware of, that you can just, you know, take somebody's land in court. So to be aware of the law and the proper filings, lawyers know this, and if the citizens should know some of these laws too, so they don't get their property ripped off, or they can take legitimate possession of houses. I'd like a small farm with a barn on it, rather than the barn just falling down into the ground. I'd like to have something like that. Sorry to interrupt. You were on the roll.
Well, if you're going to take adverse possession, my suggestion is to get adverse possession of somebody in the early phases of Alzheimer's. I mean, take his property.
Yep.
Somebody who was born in Korea or some serious non-English speaking country, and who has no heirs, children, or cousins or whatever whatsoever in the United States. That's the perfect place to take adverse possession. First of all, if the person is incapacitated, it's very likely that the government hasn't appointed a guardian or conservator over his stuff. And I mean, it's possible. And if he has, if he croaks, it's likely or possible that there won't be any probate issues over it, especially if he doesn't owe a mortgage. So if this person owns a house free and clear and gets, you know, Alzheimer's or something like that, he's certainly not going to pay attention to the property for long. And as a consequence, that'd be a property to take adverse possession of, because when the person dies, you can just, you know, as long as you file notice of adverse possession, you can go in and take, end up fulfilling the statute of limitations, and you'll end up with a piece of property. Then, once you have the property through adverse possession and you've completed the statute of limitations, in Florida, you should file a quiet title lawsuit and ask the court to confer complete, full, unfettered title, legal and equitable, upon you. If the property has a mortgage on it, and the mortgagee sleeps that long and doesn't take tax property, well, guess what? You'll probably be able to beat the mortgagee out of it. It's not likely that that had happened, because mortgagees aren't that stupid. So anyway, it does boil down to you might say, screwing somebody out of their property for you to take adverse possession of it. But in the case of people who have abandoned their property, they don't care anyway, so what's the point of worrying about it? You know, it'd be like if you took a wallet with a $1,000 bill, or let's say $20,000 poking out of it, and laid it on a park bench and walked, you know, 200 feet away from it. How surprised would you feel that somebody would come along and grab that wallet and walk off with it? Not very.
Yeah.
It's human nature. If people see it, it looks valuable, and they're willing to do whatever work is associated with it, they get to keep it. Finders keepers, losers weepers. Sorry, but it's a fundamental principle. But notice that there are people who take a very dim view of this. They resent it because they're economically jealous. In other words, they don't want you to go get something you didn't have to work for. And if you're an adverse possessor, they resent you. It's an economic kind of resentment that they had to pay a lot of money for their house. And that's one of the things I think motivates the sheriffs and the police. They look at the little dingy house they live in and think, who in the hell are you? I had to work my butt off to get this house. Who are you to be able to get a better house for nothing? And they resent it. And that means they come in and double up on their efforts to make an adverse possessor's life miserable. Now, I know of numerous of them that have been arrested for scheme to defraud, grand theft, theft, criminal mischief, breaking and entering, burglary, and so forth, and trespass. One man recently got arrested for trespass after the detective came by and interviewed him three times. And it was a policeman, came by and interviewed him, walked up on his porch and talked to him. Well, what the man, I mean, part of the problem here is that people don't know how to deal with the cops when they come causing trouble like this. Now, the question is, do the cops have any right? Well, if the owner didn't tell them to get off the land, the cops have no right. The cops owe due diligence to understand, has the house been
broken into.
Abandoned. And if it has, if somebody came in and took it over, it's no business of the police.
Yep.
That's to begin with. The second issue is mortgage companies, mortgagees, do not have equitable title to the property. They have legal title. The person who borrows money for buying a house conveys legal title to the mortgagee or the lender, whichever's name is on that document, the mortgage security instrument.
Yep.
And by conveying title, it's legal title. That means it has only the purpose of fulfilling the requirements of the mortgage, which is, you know, making sure the investment is protected and the person doesn't destroy and that sort of thing. Or that if some flood or whatever happens to it, any insurance money comes in has to be go to pay for the house. So what happens is we have a situation where the mortgagee does not have equitable title. Equitable title basically means the right to determine who gets to possess the property. Within the constraints of the loan, which requires that the borrower live there for, I think, a year before he can rent it out or do something else with it, as long as he's within those constraints, the mortgage company has no authority over him except to make sure that he spends any insurance money on the property and he doesn't let the place deteriorate. Well, if he abandons it, he's letting it deteriorate. So if an adverse possessor comes in and takes care of it, it suddenly becomes no business of the mortgagee any longer. As long as it's being cared for, it's not the mortgagee's business. Only the owner has possessory dominion, possessory rights in the property as the equitable owner. And that's the guy who borrowed the money. So guess what? The mortgagee doesn't have the authority to swear out a trespass warning. And only person who does is the owner, not the owner's son or daughter or anybody else that is a family member or a close friend. The homeowner's association doesn't have the authority. Nobody does but the owner.
Unless they're a renter, they can, if they have...
Well, then in that case, the owner, the equitable owner, has conferred upon the renter possessory dominion within certain constraints, as long as he pays his rent and so forth. So the renter has equitable rights in the property that were the owner's, the equitable owner's, but the owner gave them up in exchange for rent money. So that means that only the person with equitable interest and possessory dominion has the authority to call the cops and tell somebody to leave the property. I mean, that would be like if the landlord rents the property out to a renter, and the renter's scurrilous, no good brother-in-law comes in and lives in the place while the renter's on vacation. The owner still doesn't have any authority to come in and tell the scurrilous guy to get out. It's none of his business. Unless, of course, he's got a provision in the rental agreement to include that person. So our issue here is that adverse possession is extremely touchy. For example, if a sheriff comes and arrests you for grand theft and scheme to defraud, if you have taken adverse possession of a house and then rented it out, if the sheriff does this, it could cost you as much as $12,000 to get out of jail on a bond. Well, $12,000 would break a lot of people. I mean, you spend that much money, unless you're a big wheeler, you're not going to be able to recover from it very easily, and you won't be able to even hire a defense attorney. So, but unless you have plenty of reserve money.
But if you,
so
if
the
you
first
fight-
thing I would tell an adverse possessor is, if you're going to take adverse possession, you better have a lot of money stashed away to defend yourself if the sheriff comes after you.
Or you file the proper paperwork in the court to get it to go through, and then you have the proper paperwork.
Well, we'll get to that in a minute.
Yeah.
But the next thing is I wanted to point out that I know a lot of people who are sitting in jail or waiting for trial right now who have been arrested for these various things that I mentioned. One person in particular, you can Google his name, Joel McNair, adverse possession, and McNair. If you Google him, you'll see a story that I wrote about him. And his name was also in the news in Tampa area. And what he did He had adverse possession of over 100 houses. He got arrested in November and December of 2010. And then in May, late May of 2011, he received a phone call from the sheriff of Manatee County and or a deputy there who told him, yeah, there's a warrant for your arrest. You want to come in peaceably? You want us to come get you? And he says, yeah, don't worry. Well, the next morning, he hung himself in his garage, committed suicide. This guy was no ding-dong. He's a very smart man, but he'd done a prison stretch for several years, 25 years ago. He knew he would spend his life there because they'd do his best to bury him. His cousin was Ron McNair, an MIT scientist and mathematician and astronaut who got killed in the Challenger accident.
Yep.
So Joel McNair was a fine man, in my opinion. But I didn't know him very long, and there are other people who have different opinions about him because he was kind of like, you know, a businessman, an entrepreneur, and entrepreneurs often alienate other people because they don't let much grass grow under their feet, and they do go get their job done. So sometimes other people get burnt or crispy fried in the process. It's like a moth getting too close to the flame, you know.
But if he had filed the, if he had 100 houses and he had all sorts of money, he should have on those last two houses.
He didn't. The cops interfered with all those people, went in there and told them, harassed them, interviewed them at 11 o'clock at night, 1 o'clock in the morning. And they told them, hey, you don't have to pay him. He's just a thief. They stirred up all kinds of trouble. And, you know, basic tortious conduct by the sheriff, Sarasota Sheriff's Department, Florida. So I wrote a story about this. I looked at the arrest documents for Joel McNair in the 2010 thing.
Yeah.
And in the interviews and the police report, the interviews that the deputies did with various people, one of them, they said that the father of a man who owned a house that Joel had adversely possessed filed a trespass warning with the sheriff. Well, the father doesn't have a legal authority to do that, and the sheriff got it and presented it. That means the sheriff is complicit in fundamentally an abuse of process in a criminal issue. That is at least a second-degree misdemeanor. And I mean, for a sheriff to do this, falsify and allow somebody to falsify a document and to be complicit in it, he's a partner to perjury and you know, an accessory to crimes. It's bad. And then the signature, and so, the deputy in Sarasota County who made the complaint against they wrote up the affidavit of probable cause against Joel McNair, lied in the affidavit, and said that Joel had failed to comply with the law. He hadn't failed to comply with it. And then the alleged magistrate who signed it with some kind of an indecipherable scribble that with no rubber stamp to say who it was or anything, so there is no way of demonstrating who the magistrate actually was, which makes me think some sheriff's deputy did it. And so, you know, they just squiggled it on there. In other words, they lied. They committed fraud. They committed fraud on the court. And they had a man in prison unlawfully. And what he should have done is filed a petition for writ of habeas corpus. And that brings me to this next point. Every adverse possessor needs to look up and understand the laws of habeas corpus in his state. In Florida, it's chapter 79, and there's a provision in the U.S. Constitution, and there's a provision in the Florida Constitution respecting habeas corpus. I suggest you become intimately familiar with it, and if necessary, memorize what you can of it, and practice writing a petition for writ of habeas corpus, because almost invariably, there will be serious problems with the accusatory documentation. The affidavit of probable cause will not be signed under penalties of perjury or sworn to. There will be lies in the associated investigation which would nullify the affidavit of probable cause. The affidavit of probable cause may have lies in it, and that would nullify it.
From what you've told, you say that you have to know.
Go ahead. people need to be ready with this habeas corpus petition in order to deal with this.
Okay, you talked about the reputation of the police and the courts. I agree. I know that from having a house in Stafford Springs, a cop that likes my wife can just show up and start slamming me up against the my house, telling me he's going to arrest me. I can. I got attacked on my property by a mugger, and four police officers committed perjury, saying that. Well, I didn't never ask to make a complaint. Well, long story short, I got a year in jail for that offense. But in New Hampshire, Jaffrey, insurance agents with the town hall people, they canceled the insurance, and then the mortgage repossessed. And then the insurance agent, the mortgage people, and the town hall people split the money when they sell the house. They make deals. My buddy in Maine, he was supposed to get his aunt's farm. The town hall people there took possession of his house instead of him getting it for his inheritance. So it's all based on the honesty of the police, honesty of the courts, and knowing the law. But there's certain places, even just to buy a house the regular way, maybe you don't want to do it because the courts and the are dishonest, the police are dishonest, and they'll just end up taking your house that you legitimately bought. But sorry to get off subject, and go ahead.
Well, I guess you're making a point, and I'm going to go ahead and put an exclamation behind the point. And that point is this. When you interact with people in government, you should record everything and have an eyewitness with you who is able and willing to write out and sign and swear to an affidavit regarding the incident. I have forms that I've made up for affidavits that have to do with a narrative affidavit, and one is to check off boxes of various crimes that got committed, so that people can support one another when they have encounters with the law, people in government.
The organized crime.
In government. It's not just the cops.
Yep.
It could be an obnoxious county clerk, tax collector, or property appraiser, or just a simple public servant that's not an officer or not the main officer. Like, you wouldn't expect the county clerk to give you too much trouble, but they sometimes get arrogant. And judges will get arrogant. Bailiffs will bump you around and pepper spray you, wrestle you to the ground, and do all kind of things. They'll just drag you out of court if they want. So you need to have witnesses whenever you have an encounter with anybody in government. You need to have at least one, and ideally two witnesses, because it's going to end up being your word against theirs, and you're going to lose if you don't have a witness and a record. The second thing is, everybody should go to eBay and look around on eBay for surveillance equipment that includes the following: a ballpoint pen high-definition camera with audio, a sunglasses or eyeglasses camcorder. It's got the lens right between the eyepieces on the plastic frame.
Yep.
With sound, with volume and various other adjustments, and even a micro SD USB chip that can go into it, and 1080 resolution. So you can be standing there looking at somebody and recording everything they're saying. That doesn't mean you're necessarily going to get away with it, but you should do it. In other words, the cop or whatever can recognize this and snatch the glasses off your head or the pen out of your pocket.
And then beat the living crap out of you, too.
Well, they could. But the point is, that's why you have witnesses doing the same thing, mm-hmm. recording everything. So I'll give you an example. The example is the very one you uploaded from Francis Canese. The ABC people came down and did an interview, and we knew good and well they would lie, that they would deceive the public and distort the story. We have a two-hour presentation, basically a recording of the meeting from which the ABC News people made their excerpts.
And I uploaded that on YouTube. So
you posted it. So yep. What that means is, because of you and Francis Canese, the public can see with crystal clarity how ABC operates to distort the truth and give people a false impression in order to create red flags and red herrings and to scare the hell out of people and make them think sovereign citizens and regular other folks are just evil criminal domestic terrorists, murderers, and the like. and idiots on top of it.
Well,
so
anybody that knows the law, I guess if you really know the law, you could be considered a sovereign citizen because you're not putting up with their crap.
Well, not putting up with their crap, I don't look at it as the proper way to express it, not because I want to disagree with you, but yeah, because it's inflammatory unnecessarily. Let me tell you this. A lot of people in government become part of a community of policy-oriented activity. They have bosses upon bosses in them that get together and decide on policy, and the underlings simply go along with it, not knowing any better, or maybe they sometimes know better, but it's kind of hard because they don't know all the details. And they know they don't know all the details, so they just do their job. Shut up, do your job. Well, when people do that, and they become part of the systematic injury of others' rights, a lot of times they're not really fully aware of it, or they may have developed a cultural attitude against the public or against certain pieces of people of the public who are vocal. Some people, like, I'm going to give you this example. If you saw that story that I did on loyalty oaths in Florida, the Catherine Harris back in 2000, or her underling in the she was the State Department head, Secretary of State of Florida under Jeb Bush, and about the year 2000, she or one of her underlings caused all of the election-related forms to have the jurat, the place where notaries sign and put a seal on it that they have administered an oath to somebody.
So they didn't have
the jurat removed and replaced with a penalty of perjury statement.
Yep.
Well, in 2007, I noticed this, or 2006, and I made such a stink about it that in 2007, in July, the State Department changed the form back to the way they should have been, put the jurat back on them. Well, that's nice. That says that there was a mistake. We don't know who made it, but it was probably political, and it was certainly stupid. And if you point it out to the right kind of people in the right way and show them the law and show them what they did wrong, they'll typically fix it because they don't want to do wrong. They'll talk about it and figure it out and say, oops, I guess we better fix this, and they fix it.
We can make Jeb Bush return his payback, and whatever, if people weren't allowed to sit on the benches, they weren't really judges, so their decisions aren't.
Well, now you bring up the political, I guess you'd say policy side of it. Fundamentally, people are going to say, look, there are de facto officers, and they try to apply this doctrine, even though it doesn't really apply. Here's the point. There was a six-year period of time when there not a single person in Florida was validly elected to office, okay?
Or put in jail.
What are you going to do about this? You're going to overturn every conviction, every act of government? No, it's not going to happen. Get used to it. So
yeah, your divorce is the final.
You just have to be pragmatic about some of these things, because if you go in there and sue, there is no judge going to let you win unless he's on his way out. It's his last day at work, and he just wants to stick it to him. Okay? You're not going to get a judge's ruling in your favor, no matter how right you are, because it would turn stuff upside down too much. So that is one of the reasons. You could call that estoppel by failing to take action. It's called latches. So, latches don't apply in Florida, but there are certain ways that you can stop yourself from acting. If you sleep on your rights for too long, you've got a statute of limitations that protects the other person.
Well, you bring up an interesting point that judges don't have to follow the law. It doesn't matter what the law book says, whatever else, they decide, and
hey,
that's it.
So judges have to follow the law, but in order to make them follow the law, you have to have political clout. You better not be standing outside yelling at them all by yourself, because the bailiffs are going to come out and, you know, pound on you. What you have to do is get 5,000 people out there screaming about it, writing letters to the press and writing to the legislators and demanding his ouster, and writing to the House Judiciary Committee and demanding the impeachment of this guy. You cannot do this stuff all by yourself. You could, but that would be called assassination. And definitely die as a consequence of something like that.
You could possibly die. I tried to remove a judge. That's why I went to the legislators trying to remove a judge, And I resisted being mugged, and the judge that I tried to have removed is the one that sentenced me a year in jail for resisting being mugged on my own property. And
well, guess what? Your fight's not over unless you say it's over. You know, the one problem with so many people is they get the hell beat out of them. Then they get up beat up in court, and again they get beat up and they lose. They eventually give up. But the people who stick with it will eventually wear them down. It's just how much abuse can you take? That's if you live through it. That is why we need to be court watchers. I've written a book on the subject, and we need to help one another by participating in one another's court actions, showing up and is a show of strength, and let judges know that we got an eye on them. Now, I want to go back to our issue of adverse possession, because there's another point that has to do with the overall strategy of adverse possession. It is the most important point. Aside from studying adverse possession to find out what it is, scouring the news to find out who has been getting arrested for it, under what name,
yep,
and who's doing the arresting, you need to realize that adverse possession puts you in harm's way. You're coming under scrutiny by the cops, the sheriff, and your neighbors, and the homeowners association, and if they can, they're going to bump you out. So you have to realize that you're not walking a tightrope, but you're in a minefield, you're in a danger zone, and you're putting yourself in harm's way. You have to have some money to get yourself out of trouble, and you need to have an escape plan. So what I suggest, you need one anyway if you're doing adverse possession of foreclosure, abandoned realty, because you're not going to stay there for more than a couple of years. So what you do is, first of all, sell all your stuff that you don't absolutely need, which is most of the stuff you own. Get rid of everything except their small set of clothing that you need, a few dishes and pots and pans, and get rid of all your knickknacks, all your junk, all your pictures and memorabilia of nonsense from your past. And just dump it. Get rid of it. I'll tell you what, give it to the Historical Society. They might actually keep it, because if you give it to your relatives, one of these days they'll set it on the curb and the garbage man will get it.
There you go.
So take all of your stuff and get rid of it, and get some folding chairs and tables and some inflatable furniture like an air mattress and a couch made out of air so that you can deflate them, pack your stuff in boxes, and be out of that house in 4 hours, clean as a whistle, with everything put in the back of your van. If you do this and travel, live like a gypsy, so to speak, you will actually enjoy the freedom of it, because you won't have all of this stuff weighing you down. You'll still be able to live a comfortable life, and you'll minimize your risk because you can pick up and move easily. And if, you know, the next thing is put surveillance equipment into the house. Put a camera out on the street so that it looks down the street and can see any license plate of any car that parks in front of the house. Put one at the front and the back door and one down the hallway, both directions, so you can see who enters the house. And hook it up to the internet so that it'll beep you if the cameras detect movement. If you do this, you will know if somebody invades your house, because they often will. They'll break in and steal your stuff and run off, especially if it's in foreclosure. So don't, you know, you have to protect yourself and protect your property, and at least it'll give you a heads up if you see any police uniforms. So, you know, the point is, put surveillance equipment in your adversely possessed house. For a whole package, it'll probably cost you less than $400 enough cameras and a little box and your internet package.
I should have done that for the house I legitimately bought. I got through a realtor, bought it, fixed it up, and the cops are sending people in to break into it. So to have cameras, at least I could have gotten the cops and their informants who are breaking into my place, which is something.
Especially if you have a camp out on the front porch, because people often talk on the front porch. So you know, rig yourself up so that you can find out who is there. If anybody does come to the place, put no trespassing signs. You could put a statement on it if you want to put a target on you that says, I'm an adverse possessor, no trespassing by anybody but the owner. And everybody else stay out. if you're not the owner, you're not an agent of the equitable owner, not the title owner, the legal owner, but the equitable owner, stay out of this property. You have no business here. It is being cared for and that. So it also could help to make friends with your neighbors if you can do it in such a way they don't become economically jealous. You know, try to be kind and good and gracious to them. Invite them in, and don't get into personal details about your house and all that. Just be real sweet to them, because they'll be more loyal to you if you do.
They're your neighbors.
And try to get their loyalty. Talk to them about legal issues in a gentle way so they can understand them, but not get too opinionated against you. All right, here's the real issue. Before doing adverse possession, if you don't know how the cops are going to behave, or if you know that they are going to come and arrest people for various kinds of crimes, it's like arresting a black man for driving while black, but calling it illegal U-turn.
Yeah, or have a taillight out, you get beaten to almost death.
The tail of the car on the way to give him a ticket, and they smash his taillight and give him a ticket for having a broken taillight.
Yep.
But it's really a ticket for driving while black.
Yep.
So that happens a lot, and it happens to adverse possessors. It's living while an adverse possessor. That's what you get ticketed for adverse possession, but they don't write that on the ticket. They write trespassing or something.
Not having a grandfather in the cemetery.
Yeah. So to forestall a lot of this difficulty, one should file a declaratory judgment lawsuit in the circuit court in Florida. It's the equivalent of a superior court in states, the district court in Texas, the circuit court in Florida. The circuit courts in Florida, according to the Constitution of Florida, have exclusive original jurisdiction over ownership of real estate. And so therefore you file a declaratory judgment in the circuit court, and you name the attorney general, the state attorney, or in Texas it would be district attorney, the sheriff, the local police chief, the property appraiser, the tax collector. Let's see, who didn't I name? Okay, that's and the statewide prosecutor. You name all these people because also the head of the Department of Law Enforcement for the state. All of these people are the ones who give adverse possessors grief one way or another. So you name them all in the lawsuit, and you're asking the court to declare your rights with respect to adverse possession. That would be, if I take adverse possession of a house, well, first of all, is adverse possession a right? Do I have the right to take adverse possession of property? Yes or no?
Yes.
If I do have the right, who has the right to tell me to get off the property? Only the owner, or the owner's agent, or does somebody else have the right in addition to the owner? The equitable owner. How about the title owner, the legal owner? Under what circumstances do the legal owner have the right to tell me to get off the property? And also, does the sheriff have the right to come arrest me for any one of the following crimes? Grand theft, theft, burglary, breaking and entering, fraud, scheme to defraud, conspiracy, criminal mischief, burglary. Did I say that already?
Yeah, I believe so. But if I'm...
So you got the idea. All the crimes that they've been arresting people for. So, and the judge is going to come back and say yes, no, yes, no, and you'd like to have a finding of fact and conclusion of law with each one of the rulings. What this does is, at the end of all this, you can bet in the process the attorney general, the state attorney or district attorney, they're going to come at you, and so will the attorney for the police department. They're going to come at you and say, oh, hell no, you don't have a right to adverse possess. You've got to turn around and say, yeah, I do. 600 years of English and Florida law, the United States law, say I do. Now, we've got a law in Florida. I want to read this briefly, not to overdo this, but simply to read this. First of all, to say that Chapter 86 of the Florida statutes deals with a declaratory judgment, and Chapter 95 deals with adverse possession. There are two titles or two sections, 95.16, which is adverse possession under color of title, 95.18 without color or title. That's the one I'm going to read. But before I read this, I'm not going to read it all just to give you the point about it. I want to point out that this color of title thing means you have some document that can show you have a legal right to be there. Well, guess what the best document to get is if you're taking adverse possession of foreclosure abandoned realty? It is a quitclaim deed. If, for the most part, if the owner is mad and has left and he's giving it up and throwing it out, why not go to the owner and say, hey, look, here's $200. Give me a quitclaim deed for the place, because otherwise the sheriff's going to harass me. What I'll do is I'll go take care of the place and I'm protecting your interest. People who go to my blog should look for the article called Benefits of Adverse Possession. I've written this article as a sample letter. You'll find it at ScribD and at bobhurt.blogspot.com. And what its purpose is to notify the actual owner of the property that you're helping him out by taking care of his obligations, and that it's benefiting everybody. Nobody loses by the adverse possessor being there. This way, at least the owner will not swear out a trespass warning. But it's far better to go to the owner and say, look, why don't you just give me a quitclaim deed? Now you can file a notice of adverse possession with color of title under 95.16. Even though you know you might get kicked off, you can still do things like pay the taxes through paying tax liens if you can, you know, the tax, buying the tax deeds or tax liens. And then, you know, you're preserving and maintaining and taking care of the property. And every time you spend a penny on this place, you file, you keep records of it, and periodically you file a lien against the property for that additional amount of money the property owes you for its care.
Yep.
Now, this money would normally come out of the owner's pocket, but he's not there. He abandoned it. You're doing it.
Yep.
So you ask the owner for a quitclaim deed, and if he gives it to you, you're guaranteed to be left alone by the cops, because they will not come in and say you've stolen the property or you're trespassing when you've got a quitclaim deed. You're not going to last forever, because eventually the foreclosure is going to go through and you'll lose it anyway. But at least you can keep the law enforcers off your back and shut the neighbors up, because you can say you're the new owner. All right, so the other way is to get the owner to say, hey, look, owner, I'll give you $200 a month rent to live in the property. And the owner is going to say, get out of here. I don't want a renter. They say, well, look, the point is I'm actually going to be taking care of it, but at least you can be throwing the mortgage company $200 a month if you want to. I'll pay it to you in cash, so what you do with it is up to you. You know, I mean, but your mortgage requires that you pay rents to the mortgagee.
Yep.
If you get any. So what that does is it throws a couple of dollars at him. It gives him an incentive to work with you. And if he signs over to you then permission to live there,
yep,
that's another act, not rent, but just permission to live there.
Yep.
Or he could hire you for some nominal thing like $5 a year to be a caretaker for the place with the right to live there. See, that way he just gives you fundamentally permission to be there, and you know, you've got a valid contract and the cops will leave you alone. So I look at those as better than adverse possession, because adverse possession, it really puts you on the radar. For example, you have to file a notice of adverse possession with the property appraiser. The property appraiser always gives this notice over to the lender, over to the police.
Yep.
And the police are always going to come by and try to harass people. Not always, but they do it a lot. So you just don't know what they're going to do. You can't trust them, so therefore, better not to tell them anything if you don't have to.
Yep.
So I don't recommend adverse possession as, you know, the cool way to go take property. I think there are ways to take property without adversely possessing it and putting the government on notice, because it's none of their business. It's far better to get a deal with the owner if you can find him, and you only therefore would take adverse possession of when you cannot find the owner.
Yep.
Unless you do it under color of title with a quitclaim deed. All right, so let me read this, okay? Real property actions, adverse possession, Florida statute 95.18. This is under color, without color of title. When the occupant has, or those under whom the occupant claims have, been in actual continued occupation of the real property for 7 years under a claim of title, exclusive of any other right, but not found on a written instrument. You have a claim of title, you see, if you take it over because it's abandoned.
Yep.
You have the right to go take it. There's nobody saying you don't have that right. Judgment, but not founded on a written instrument, judgment, or decree. The property actually occupied is held adversely if the person claiming adverse possession made a return as required under subsection 3 of the property by legal, proper legal description to the property appraiser of the county where it's located within 1 year after entering into possession and has subsequently paid, subject to the Florida statute 197.3335, all taxes and matured installments of special improvement liens levied against the property by the state, county, and municipality. For the purpose of this section, property is deemed to be possessed if the property has been A, protected by substantial enclosure, B, cultivated or improved in an unusual manner, or C, occupied and maintained. Now look, there's more to this. And it says, three, a person claiming adverse possession under this section must make a return of the property by providing to the property appraiser a uniform return on a form provided by the Department of Revenue, includes the following information. It gives you a bunch of stuff. But I want to go back to item one, where it says, when the occupant has, comma, or those under whom the occupant claims have, comma, been an actual continued occupation of the property for 7 years. Listen, it says those under whom the occupant claims have. When the occupant has or those under whom the occupant claims. Who would be somebody under the occupant? A renter. This paragraph expressly indicates that, or implicitly indicates, that an adverse possessor could rent the property out or put somebody else in it for the time being.
Yeah.
But by exercising possessory dominion, in other words, behaving like the owner, the adverse possessor is living according to his rights. What I'm saying is that this statute acknowledges the right of an adverse possessor to live on the property and rent it out.
Yep.
You get it? The point is that this right here, it shoots a bullet in the head of all sheriff's complaints and arguments that somebody's stealing the property. Because the only way you'll be able to do this is if the owner doesn't care. The owner is turning a blind eye to it. He doesn't care. He's not trying to get you off the property. He isn't complaining about trespass. He's not suing for some kind of writ of possession. So as a consequence, it's no business of the sheriff whatsoever. And the sheriffs have not yet learned this because all the people they've been arresting in Florida, there are two people I know of who have received a conviction, but they've been as a consequence of plea bargains. One was about 2 or 3 weeks ago, got a man named George Williams in Tampa, and the other was Mark Burette. That was 2 or 3 years ago down in West Palm in Palm Beach County. So both of them had taken more than one house in adverse possession.
Uh-huh.
All right, so now here's what has happened. I have explained what adverse possession is in Florida, but every state has variations of these rules. I have explained that it has a 600-year history, which is not documented in any state's laws. You will not find adverse possession related to the English law discussed in Florida law, nor in any state's law, but you will find a provision in the state law that specifically claims that the English statute and common law are the law of the state, except as inconsistent with the U.S. Constitution or laws or the laws of Florida. So guess what? What does that mean? That means we have an English law of Florida.
Yep.
Will the real English law of Florida please stand up? Who knows what that law is? Raise your hand. Well, I can promise you no sheriff knows it, not one, in America. Most state attorneys have no clue about it. I don't know of a single attorney at all who knows anything about it. Most judges don't know what it is, although they can go look for it in Black's commentaries and certain other law books. My point here is that there are a lot of things in the English law that lead up to Florida Statute 95.18 and 95.16. But the people in government don't know what those laws are any more than the people being governed know what they are. And if you can't know the law, you can't observe it, obey it, or enforce it. So one thing that needs to be declared in a declaratory action under Chapter 86 is that English law exists, but that people in government do not, almost universally, do not know what it is, and therefore cannot enforce it and cannot protect people's rights under it. But the Supreme Court of Florida has said that the legislature cannot take away a common law right without providing a suitable statutory substitute. Well, Chapter 95.18 takes away that right by requiring an onerous notification to the property appraiser, who is then going to notify the owner, stirring up shit, so to speak. In other words, making a big, nasty fracas and mess out of it, alerting and alarming everyone. And he will always inform the sheriff that adverse possession has happened, and that is going to bring the adverse possessor under persecution, which he would never have had to suffer otherwise. So what this has done is that it has definitely interfered with the common law right and with the right in the Florida Constitution under Article 1, Section 23, that everybody, every person has the right to privacy and to be let alone free from government intrusion into the person's private life. This is an intrusion into the person's private life to require him to file this onerous notice and affidavit, because all the affidavit is expose him to penalties of perjury in case he happened to lie, and there's not much of a lie going on in adverse possession. You're either possessing it or you're not. This thing has tried to stir up trouble, and it needs to be thrown out. This law is unconstitutional. It is unconstitutional according to the rules of the Florida Supreme Court, and to the ruling of the Florida Supreme Court in a 1973 case. If you want to know what it is, I'll look at it. It's Kluger v. White. Go Google Kluger, K-L-U-G-E-R, V versus White, W-H-I-T-E.
Is it Kluger with a C or K?
What?
Is it C or K in Kluger?
K. K-L-G-E-R.
Okay.
Kluger v. White. If you look that case up, you will find that I've written some comments about it or related to it, but there's a Florida Bar Journal article that is beautifully written that discusses the English law of Florida and these issues to some extent. But I think that we also, in the Chapter 86 declaratory judgment lawsuit, should demand that the Supreme Court tell us, or that the court tell us, what the English law of Florida is. In other words, we want the Supreme Court to declare, or the courts of Florida, we wish the legislature would do it, but at least the court should declare, what is the English law of Florida? Name the specific books it's in and make them part of Florida's written books of Florida laws or statutes of Florida. Because after all, Statute 2.01 refers to it. But what we really need is 2.01 refers to it with the exception of any laws that are not consistent with the U.S. Constitution and laws or the statutes of Florida. Well, which English laws are those that aren't consistent? Or that we want to know which ones are consistent, because that way we can X out a whole bunch of them that aren't consistent. Now, they're the ones that are of a general and not a local nature. So, hey, maybe we need to take out Blackstone's commentaries and put them in every library across the land. But to put them online, I guess you can't find them online. But my point here is that it is a terribly horrible, difficult job for the average person, whether in law enforcement or not, or whether they're in the courts or a law office or not, to discern what the English law of Florida is. And if you can't know what it is, then you can't really speak about it intelligently. But I would say that Chapter 95, Section 18 and 16 that deal with adverse possession make it crystal clear there's a whole lot of preceding law, a huge body of it that went before this statute, because this statute implies we have the right of adverse possession, but it doesn't get it come down and say so. It implies that you have the right to rent a property out or put somebody else in it while you're exercising possessory dominion on it as an adverse possessor. It doesn't come out and say so.
I'm going to put plenty of keywords in this video and where I post it. I want people like me to network so we inform each other, so we don't get taken advantage of in courts or by the police. And if we keep in touch with each other, some sort of email list, and I plan on doing some sort of film, you know, it doesn't take a lot of money to do that, this would be one of the subjects that I cover, and that way people get an education that are considering doing it. Law enforcement gets an idea of this is legal to do, and same thing with the courts. And the judges and the lawyers and all that, they can't do just whatever they want whenever they want.
And, well, there exists two or three such things right now. I have a mailing list that I set up for law philosophers, which I call Lawsters, LAWSTERS. If anybody wants to subscribe to that group and promises not to act like an idiot, because we're interacting with law professionals here that truly are law philosophers, then I can subscribe them if they request it. Send email to bob@bobhurt.com, and you know I'll consider their request. The second thing is that anybody and everybody can subscribe to my lawmen group, LAWMEN plus subscribe, that's the plus sign, at googlegroups.com. Lawmen plus subscribe at googlegroups.com. Just send email there, and then I've got about 1,600 members or subscribers. You can join this. It doesn't cost you anything. I'm the only person who posts to the group, and I post law and political commentary. Okay, so the third thing is, if you're interested in adverse possession, I've already created an adverse possession law advocacy group mailing list. You would subscribe to it by sending email to adverse possession plus subscribe at googlegroups.com. Adverse possession plus sign subscribe at googlegroups.com.
And I'll post my information also. We'll be in contact back and forth. But I want to make sure that across the nation, when people are having trouble in court, and they're being jackasses about it, to post about it, get people involved. And guess what? A lot of times, if you catch the court in time and show these officials doing wrong, you can get them to do right because they know people are watching. You put lights on cockroaches. And an interesting point that you brought up is, you know, why have a lawyer? Like, I believe in pro se of defending yourself, but you mentioned that if you can have an organized crime lawyer, if you find one that's connected, bribing the judge and all that, then you have somebody that bribes the judge, whereas you can't go and directly bribe the judge. I can cut this out of the interview if you want.
You shouldn't talk about it that way, but let me make a comment about it.
Yep.
You know, the issue here is this. If a lawyer has a reputation for winning in court a lot,
yep,
in a specific courtroom, that clearly indicates that he's got an in with the judge. It doesn't guarantee it, but if you can find something out like that and you're looking for a lawyer to defend you, it makes really good sense to go to a lawyer like that. All right, he may not be the one that's the most ethical, but he has a good chance of winning. So that's one point. It also helps to have a meritorious case. A lot of times people do crooked things and wrong things, and they're wrong. So take your butt medicine, you know, and stop complaining. But there are plenty of people who are in jail as political prisoners who didn't do anything wrong except stand up for their rights. And maybe you were one of those. So I have a friend who's an absolute expert at beating the stuffing out of prosecutors in court. His name is Storm Bradford, and you can see what the kind of work that he does at instantlawpartner.com. Instantlawpartner.com. Now, Storm Bradford has got 35 years experience. He has won probably over 90% of 750 criminal proceedings by beating up the prosecutor and destroying his case, and by counseling the defense attorney on how to do it, on what not to do, what to do. He has told me that most courts are not crooked, that the judges want to do a good job, they try to do a good job, but it is only up to the judge to step on the gas and step on the brakes as he's driving the bus and to steer the bus here and there. But he follows the directions of the attorneys, the litigants. And there are certain things he cannot or will not do because he knows the rules prohibit it. But within those constraints, there are many things he can do and will do if one of the adversaries asks him to do it through a proper motion. Or the adversaries can give him special information through judicial notice. By entering evidence, you create the facts of the case. With no evidence entered, it's not a fact. So the judge gets to make whatever decision he wants. There are all kinds of things people do not understand about judges and judging. And because of this, they assume the attorney was crooked when in reality, or the judge was crooked when in reality, the attorney was just incompetent. And there are a lot of incompetent attorneys. That doesn't mean they're not worth the powder to blow them to hell. It just means they lack certain critical experience. A lot of them have that experience. And they win the cases that have merit. Because it's another important thing to realize that attorneys, if you have two excellent attorneys as adversaries representing clients in a really sticky court case, one's going to win and the other's going to lose. It does not matter how good they are as long as, you know, the court obeys the rules, that they obey the rules, and they present their case. The case with the most merit is going to win. And that is really the idea of court. It is to have a judge determine which one, or a jury, determine what the facts are, the judge apply the law, and the court with judge, jury, and whatever are going to make a decision, a determination, as to which party is right and which party is less right. Which party is most right, which party is less. And the extent, and whatever damages they were to help somebody break, you know, clean up the damage. Well, the point is, judges might not be perfect at it, but they're the best thing that we have. And it isn't right for us to automatically assume that there are so many crooked judges, blah, blah, blah. That doesn't mean I'm saying there are none. I'm sure there are judges on the take that are corrupt and rotten. But even rotten judges are good most of the time. Mm-hmm. You know, they may be mob connected, but usually they only vote in favor of the mob when there's mob litigants in front of them. You know, so my point is that even bad judges are probably good most of the time. So, and we should give them the benefit of the doubt and applaud and honor those who do an impeccable and a good job and who bend over backward to strive for justice tempered with mercy, fairness. And to try to help the judges do this, we should encourage them by pointing out the code of judicial conduct every once in a while and talk to them about prejudice and how it seems to be creeping in the case, if it seems to be. But we, as litigants, we must learn the rules of court and rules of evidence. We have to learn those rules of procedure and obey them and absolutely insist that our adversaries obey them. If we don't do this, or if the lawyer doesn't, then we need to get a lawyer that will do it. If we can't do it ourselves, because we're so incompetent and never studied this stuff, the wrong time to learn it is when you're trying it in the middle of litigation. You're going to get your butt kicked. and need to hire a lawyer to do this for you if you don't know how to do it. And most of us, no matter how much we study, are not going to really learn it the way lawyers do, because lawyers cut their teeth on litigation. They actually stand up in court. It's not their case, but they litigate on behalf of people, and they make their mistakes when they're young. You know, hopefully they've got supervisory attorneys over them with more seniority and experience. And that's what big law firms try to do, is gradually subject young lawyers to the various kind of processes they need to learn. Well, where are we going to learn this? This is why I suggest that everybody invest in the jurisdictionary course and buy a copy of the annotated rules of procedure, both civil and criminal, and rules of evidence for your state, and get one for the federal if you can, or at least become friendly with it. So you'll understand that what our biggest problem here is, because judges are the mommies and daddies of society, basically. And even though they make mistakes and do things wrong sometimes, they generally try to do well. But the law ultimately means only what they say it means. No matter how much we wish it meant something else, wish it meant what it said, it means what the judges say. If you take any approach other than that, you're going to get your ass handed to you in court, you're going to lose, and you're going to end up hating judges as crooked bastards when you shouldn't. When you should basically just try to buck up and do a better job in your litigation next time. It's important to understand this principle that a judge isn't crooked because he rules against you. It could be you made a bad case, or your case doesn't have the merit you think it has, or you misunderstood, or you listen to some patriot mythmongers filling your head with full of, you know, that brown smelly stuff they call BS, filling your head full of that, making you think, oh yeah, bonded promissory notes, I'll pay my debt with one of those. Oh yeah, I got a birth certificate bond, it goes back, you know, I've got millions of dollars in my treasury direct account. Well, I never heard this kind of insanity till I'm blue in the face. And those people go to jail, they go to prison for doing stuff like that. And that's because they listen to patriot mythmongers. And so we need to stay away from those. And that's what I do. I try to help instruct people in the law and the proper use of procedure. All the time, I'm a student myself. I suggest people buy the jurisdictionary course and get started a meeting in your little local town in the back of a Perkins restaurant or stuff. Start inviting friends and people you meet in there to learn the law. Listen to those lessons. Listen to the audios. Read the documents. Talk about them with each other. Invite an attorney in from time to time and give a little talk to the group. They'll love doing it. Next thing you know, your room will be packed full of people. Collect $5 or $10 from everybody, put it in a kitty so you can buy some audiovisual equipment, and you can show DVDs on a big screen and so forth.
You sound like a very learned man, Bob, and it sounds like you live in a nice community too. To backtrack, I've been in the process, seen the process where judges are nominated and confirmed, and a lot of them have absolutely no experience. They just know the governor or know somebody else, and there they go. They're a judge.
You're talking about judges? That's not true. A judge has to be a bar member for a minimum of 5 years, and if he's a Supreme Court justice, 10 years.
That is
in most counties, the counties with over 40,000 people. A judge doesn't have to be a bar member, but he has to be a bar member. But there are certain, for real small counties that don't have many people, there are less stringent requirements. But my point here is that judges have to be lawyers first. And the lawyer has to be a lawyer for 5 years, and that 5 years is not bad experience. A lot of judges or lawyers are very intelligent, very bright people. And it could be a lot of people say, most of them, if they're lawyers, they weren't smart enough to cut it in business. Well, that's not true. It takes good intelligence and a lot of perseverance to get through law school, pass the bar exam. That right there cuts an awful lot of idiots out of the process and people with not very much work ethic. So, yeah, you'll find that lawyers get connected and they get full of themselves and arrogant. Sometimes they become judges. But the point is, they have a lot more knowledge about the law than most of the people appearing before them. And if the litigants study their case law properly, they will present good arguments to the court if their brains are engaged and that they have a loyalty to truth. When they present their arguments to the court, the judge is usually competent to sort out the difference between good arguments and bad arguments and read the case law for himself and make a proper and a fair determination. And in case he has to go dig up facts, we have juries. If there is a jury trial, then the jury can decide the facts. The judge can apply the law. And the judge, remember, he has access to a massive research library, so he can look things up himself. And he doesn't, it's not easy to bully him or bowl him over. Yeah, sometimes judges have personal problems. Maybe they start doing drugs. Who knows? Maybe they're kind of like sex perverts and masturbate behind the bench and they do all kinds of things that are crazy. But the vast majority of judges are good people. It is wrong to sit there and think that because you can find an isolated example of a bad judge here, a bad judge there, that they're all bad. They are not. By and large, they are good people, and they work very diligently to do a good job.
Well, if it's policy in a state, let's say Connecticut, where they want to process as many cases through as possible, and the judges are encouraged to threaten people, guilty or innocent, take this deal, or I'll really get harsh on you, or without even a lawyer being present, take this deal, and that's it. And there's
usually, if there's going to be a deal offered, it's a prosecutor that offers it, not a judge. Okay, that's point one. And prosecutors do all kinds of crazy stuff that I think they shouldn't do, but, you know, it happens anyway. For efficiency. And part of it is, if the guy doesn't accept a plea bargain, he must believe he's innocent. If he accepts a plea bargain, either they scared him or he's an idiot. Because if he's innocent, he shouldn't be taking it. So there are a lot of people that get talked into plea bargains who just shouldn't do it. They're stupid. There are a lot of stupid people in prison. A lot of them.
Yeah.
We have 75 million stupid people in America with IQ so low they can't graduate from high school. 75 million. No surprise that our prisons are loaded with them and should be even more loaded with them because they make so many bad mistakes. So, you know, it's kind of difficult to look at a system where the judge is sitting there making plea bargains. Judges don't do that, far as I know. And they may try to get into it, but anybody that sees them do it should scold them for it and remind them of the problems with prejudice.
Well, there's states that have a complaint system against judges where judges have to worry about being complained against. The state of Connecticut, they can write in black and white. They can make racist comments, right there in black and white, and then nothing's done to them.
Well, you know what? Unfortunately, there's this thing called, you know, certain qualified immunity for lawyers and policemen,
yeah,
and almost absolute immunity and torts for judges. But judges do and lawyers. And cops engage in tortious conduct sometimes and deprive others of their rights, and they shouldn't have immunity for that. I can understand their logic and their wanting it, but who the hell doesn't want to have immunity for the things he does? Everybody you talk to in prison wants immunity. They all want out.
Yeah.
They want to get away with their crime. And that's if they committed one.
Yeah, if you have a,
you know, most of the people in prison for a crime, they should have been in prison, even if it was for a different crime. I'm not trying to justify just willy-nilly people getting thrown in prison. I'm simply saying that there are multiple sides to this issue, that when you're striving to have a good government, meaning good judges, and also meaning good lawyers who are quasi-government, we need to work to improve the quality of the population in general. We need a better gene pool. We need more highly educated and informed people of greater industry. And when we have this, and to the extent we have it, as we have it, we need to curtail the suffrage for people that are either abysmally ignorant or wards of the state or felons or habitual criminals, or drug addicts, because these people don't think straight, and or hopelessly stupid, real low IQ, like IQ less than 90. What's somebody like that voting for? They can't even figure out barely how to handle their own lives. They can't understand the essences of, you know, the ideals of good government and so forth. They just don't comprehend. So our point is, we should never let those kind of people vote. The rest of the population's vote is being destroyed by the vote of people who are ignorant, stupid, and don't have a clue.
Did George Bush have a 90 IQ, or was it was probably less than that?
Whose IQ was less than that?
George W. Bush was. He isn't too bright a bulb.
George Bush had an IQ, a putative IQ of 114.
Really? Okay. I was being funny. But it's funny.
Well, I understand you can take issue with people. He was a smart guy. He got a Harvard MBA. He is not a dumbass.
Okay. I was having fun with that one, Bob.
Yeah, I got it. But anyway, I think we spent our time reasonably wisely. We got through this issue of adverse possession. It's kind of a sticky mess. I try to help a lot of people with adverse possession, but I haven't found people yet willing to give money to for the purpose of a legal defense fund for adverse possessors. Because what should happen is we ought to have a membership thing and, you know, charge people 50 bucks a month or something like that to be members of the Adverse Possession Law Advocacy Group. Because with donations from thousands of people across America, like membership dues or something, we actually could afford to contract with a law firm to provide legal assistance to adverse possessors, especially when the sheriffs come after them and try to dump them out of the house they're in and arrest them for fraudulently arrest them for crimes they didn't commit.
We talked about it already as far as you and I putting our heads together, and I think to make people aware that you can do this, it's legal, make police, people who operate the courts, legislators, and just everybody know that this is legal to do. When I post this on Op-Ed, on Live Leak on YouTube, people that do the word searches to find this will find this. And, you know, they should get a hold of you and me, and they should, you know, put a little bit of money, if this is what they want to do, put out the money to be part of a group. We'll inform you, and also we'll, you know, watch each other's back, you know, as far as pay attention to things that are going on regarding this issue and around the country.
One thing you need to do is, in that article you're going to put on Op-Ed or wherever, you need to give it some lead-ins by listing, put my full contact information. Didn't I send you an email? Did you get an email from me?
Okay, I believe so. I have your.
Okay, if you look at the bottom of that email,
yeah,
you see a little picture of me, some blog information, a subscribe thing, an e-letter thing, and you'll see a thing that says email. If they click on that email link, it will send me. It'll invoke a website that'll send me email, using their email client without divulging my email address. In other words, a spammer is not going to get it. So what you do is take that information that I have published at the bottom of my letter and put it there so people can get in touch with me by phone or by email, and they can go read the blogs and they can join the lawmen group. The one thing I didn't put in there is the adverse possession sign up. So should have the links that I described, and if you want to, I'll put it in an email and send it to you so you can put that into the message. Because, look, I know that you and I, we have a little bit different bent, but I'm not working for a living. All I do is I study law, I write commentaries, I talk to people to help them out, and every once in a while I hobnob with a nice guy like you, or maybe Francis or something.
Okay.
But I've spent years in relative isolation, you know, in an ivory tower or a dungeon, a bat cave or however you want to look at it.
In the corporate world.
Doing my thing.
Yep.
Studying, learning, writing, and talking to people about their problems. So I have a full willingness to give of myself to these projects. I don't hide. I don't charge people any money. I do accept donations, and I love donations because they really, they do make a difference and they do show appreciation. But, you know, I don't make it a condition of anything that I do. Even when I put on a seminar, I simply make a suggested donation as the fee for coming in. And I let people in free if they need to.
Since 1995, I've written letters to the editor. I used to have money. I would give money away. I volunteer for charities, and I've been helping people pretty much my entire life. And what I found out is that by getting the information out, you know, when somebody's in court and they're going to be retaliated against, they're having problems with the police, networking with other big mouths like myself to get the word out, we've helped, I mean, just countless people. And
well, let me ask you this, if you take a look at my blog and you browse down through all of the different kinds of articles I've written, I know it's a little bit, you have to click on the months and things, well, I can't help it. But if you look at the kinds of things that I've been writing over the last several years,
yeah,
you know, every once in a while I'll put a humorous one in, like I did one on lies. You know, the old statement, there's, Mark Twain said there's three kind of lies, there's liars, there's damn liars, and then there's statistics.
Yeah.
Well, I did a little article on that, and I did another one called The Pantomimes of Liars. Go read it. You'll get a kick out of it.
All right.
And I've done, you know, some interest articles, but and an awful lot of them. Some of them I do recipes on habanero peppers, hot sauce and stuff, and how to bake sourdough bread. But a lot of my stuff is legal, and some of it may be, you know, quasi-religious or philosophical in nature. There's not all that much political stuff. I could do a lot more than I do. But my point is, I think I should be writing on op-ed news. I want to know, how do I become a member of this thing so I can start publishing to it?
I'll send you how to do that. You send me what you want me to post on op-ed, and really you should. I'll send something to Rob saying that you should be on the crew here.
Well, that's good, because you can look at the quality of my work. I mean, you can hear the commentaries that I've given you.
Yeah.
Look at the quality of work. I try to research my articles pretty well, and even though I don't do the most consummate job of research, I get kind of tired of dicking with it sometimes, if you know what I mean. You know, I beat an issue to death as far as I can, and beyond that, I'm just not willing to take it all that much farther, because who's paying me for it? Nobody. So you can look and see if you think I do an adequate job of these things, but it's like if you look at that blog, you'll see that I've written several articles on adverse possession. Most recently, just a few days ago, more considerations about adverse possession strategy. You can look at the adverse possession strategy article. What I would suggest you do is, I could do it myself. I can go down there and find all the links on adverse possession strategy stuff that I have written. And you can take and post all these links up there on the Op-Ed News website, right by the interview link or whatever. That way, people have hard copy stuff to go by, not just my commentaries.
Okay. Once I post it on op-ed, I have a certain amount of time to adjust it, and sometimes it doesn't come up. First run through, I have to have my grammar right, which is hard for me. It used to be easy. I'm getting older. but on my blog, I can adjust it at any time. So what I post on my blog, starkravingviking.blogspot.com, I can go back and change. So,
well, what I should do before you, have you posted this on op-ed yet?
The adverse possession. I may have hinted towards it, but I have not posted on adverse possession.
Before you post it, let me write up these links so that you can put them in the article, or put them, you know, I don't know, by the upload.
I'll put them in the video. Links by the video, and then when I put text with video, it'll come through on the post too.
All right, well, so let me just get that written up. Give me a half an hour or so, okay?
Sure will.
I'll email it to you. So make sure your email address is...
TRVL, the short version of travel at hotmail.com.
Got it. All right, so I have that down. I'll put these links in there for you. And I want you to just take note, the little thing by my picture down there, you'll see it says contact. It's got email. There's BH, which is my Facebook page. No, BH is my website. There's F, which is Facebook, T, which is Twitter, and then blogs 1, 2, and 3. The E letter is having to do with law. There's a subscribe link, a donate link, and a jurisdictionary learn link. And then there's my address and phone number, so I don't hide at all. No. So just to let you know, I'm not trying necessarily to promote myself. I'm trying to say that a lot of times people get into this, miss something, have some nuance or detail they want to know, and they can talk with me about it if they wish.
Well, if,
free.
Everything that I've heard about you, Bob, has been good. You know, as far as I help people, you know, but some of the people that I help have very powerful, not so nice people that would like to know where I'm at. So I'm available by email and by phone, but you know, sometimes if I'm like more in Connecticut, if somebody needs help at a court or wherever else, I don't announce it. I just show up, so they don't have any advance notice.
Hey, look at my blog at bobhurt.blogspot.com. Most recent entry was an extremely inflammatory article: procreation of the stupid. Finally, some legal action against it.
You know, you're not going to make a lot of friends with that. Well, I guess they can't read.
I fucking pissed some people. Excuse me, I don't mean to get vulgar, but I didn't mean to get vulgar, but there's some picture that did, people that didn't take so much favor with this. Two people on my mailing list wrote to me, I think maybe three, and then on a different mailing list, two of them denounced me, but they're far left over leaning liberals who think everything that I would say about birth control or about, you know, improving society is crazy. But the issue here was these parents of a daughter with Down syndrome in Oregon. They were the latest couple to win a lawsuit against the hospital for wrongful birth. Is it a crime to bring a stupid child into this world? Why? Because the stupid remain children mentally even as they enter adulthood. Yeah. The stupid will cause endless problems throughout its life as children and as adults. They require incessant care to shield them from abuse by smarter people, and to shield others from abuse by them. Now, I go into this point, and then there's an article down here that talks about these people who've got this, you know, a $3 million award from the jury because the hospital allowed this child to come to term instead of aborting it. When they went into the woman to pull the fetal tissue out, guess what they got? They got her own body tissue.
Yeah.
They didn't pull the fetus out. So I thought this was a great story, but this isn't the fun part. The fun part is my response to the people who tried to nail my hide to the wall as Hitler. Okay? Because I let go of the dogs on them. I unleashed the dogs of war on their asses. You know, it's not exactly like that. I'm just tongue-in-cheek. You know, the point is that I made them look like jackasses, cretins, hateful, loathsome, evil bastards, because they actually believe it's okay to inflict this terrible disease of stupidity on innocent children. See, they want to look at me as a Hitler because I believe that these children should have been aborted, and that not just aborted, the people who give birth to stupid children, If it can be determined they themselves have low IQ, they shouldn't be allowed to procreate at all. They should be sterilized in puberty. So my whole point is, it's a step beyond this thing of aborting a Down syndrome baby. There are a lot of people born with stupidity, and a doctor can't tell they've got Down syndrome. Because they don't. They're just stupid. Because their parents are stupid. So the liberals in this country do not want to admit that stupidity is genetic in nature.
Well, somebody's limited and they're intelligent and they're a hard worker and they're over picking turnips out of a field. I think that's, you know, they're helping out society. They're probably wonderful and go to church and all the things that are considered good. You have somebody with really high intelligence, and there's a certain percentage of them that are sociopaths or psychopaths, where they weren't born with the ingredient of how to care. And so I'd rather have the neighbor who works very hard and picks up, picks his turnips out of his...
Hey, you're totally right. You're totally right. The only problem is this. The stupid guy cannot correct his condition. The socio or psychopath, he's correctable. And in any case, that doesn't mean he's going to give birth to children that are that way, that are crazy.
No,
that could have come across as a chemical problem, or his parents beat the shit out of him, or whatever. But also, it could have, been, drugs or some other issue. My main point is, you made the only and a very excellent exception to the general rule of aborting or prohibiting stupid people from having stupid children. The main point is that there is a place for the stupid doing very repetitive jobs and so forth, but they have to be compounded and protected either in a family. So we need to return to the slavery of the 1800s and the 1700s, because any landowner that had slaves typically did not brutally beat the hell out of them and abuse them because he wanted them to get meaningful work done. He took care of them, he fed them well, he gave them shelter, and so forth, and he didn't mess with them incessantly. Oh yeah, he punished them when they got out of line, and some of them got so far out of line they ran off, and so forth. But the point is that these people weren't just slave owners, they were caretakers for people that were generally stupid. You see, today's population of blacks has an average IQ of 84. Which is 1 point less than that needed to graduate from high school. So half the black kids in the country cannot graduate from high school because they don't have the cognitive ability. So they're going to gravitate toward crime and welfare abuse to get by. As so will the 33 million Caucasians with IQ below 85. But our point here is that they have it good, are the black people in America, because they're 18% white. They have better diets and a better culture to live in than the blacks in Africa. The sub-Saharan Africa has an average IQ of 70. God help us. 70. The psychometrists call that moron. Yeah. And there is one country that has an IQ of 59.
Wow.
Can you even imagine having to live around people with a 59 IQ average?
What would they be able to do and not do? This is all news to me.
Pick potatoes out of a field. And maybe not very well at that. They could stack BBs.
Well,
They could be taught things like how to sort a good-looking egg from a bad-looking egg. They can do menial tasks and simple thing, but they have to be supervised at all times.
Well, in grades 3 through 12, in third grade, I was the chess champion of Western Mass. And my father, he figured out how to make various chemicals fit together so it's a coil. He invented paint that went on plastic bumpers. Now all cars are that. So he figured out how to have two solvents at least dry into the paint so it's not in the air. It cures at a lower temperature. That's why cars can be pushed through an assembly line with plastic and vinyls in them. That's him. And in third grade, I could beat him at chess. But then who's to say that somebody with less intelligence than me, maybe they've, because of what happened to me, maybe they went farther. But I don't know. I'm just kind of, that's the whole debate where I'm more.
Hey, you're wise to do this. It's not being a devil's advocate.
Yeah.
It's trying to keep a balanced view. Trying not to go overboard and be extreme, because when you're talking about statistics, you have to generalize. You don't have a choice.
Yeah.
Because that's what statistics are. But as much as statistics may lie, they're far better than the alternative. Which is a scientific wild ass guess. Not even a swag, just like a roll of dice in a dark closet. You know, who knows? My point is to say, even though there are exceptions to the rule that stupid people have stupid children and smart people have smart children, you should not base a decision on the exceptions.
Well,
you just have to be able to waste a few. You're going to lose some.
Well, at this point, when I write screenplays for independent movies that I want to produce, it's layered. There's the simple stuff where hopefully it's kick and soundtrack that gets the the lower end there to go to the theater. I have to appeal to them. I'm not going to kill them. They're my customers.
You know what? You're right. And I have been indiscriminate. Well, I didn't present the concept I just gave you now in this little article. All I did was talk about these people. They got a judgment award because the hospital failed to abort their stupid child.
Yeah.
Because they were highly intelligent Jewish couple.
Yeah.
And Ashkenazi Jews are the smartest people on the planet, smartest racial group.
Yeah.
Average IQ of 115. So what does that mean? Hey, it means smart Jews don't want to have stupid kids. Who blames them? So the hospital failed to abort this child when it had the opportunity to do so, and now they're going to have to care for this child for the rest of its life. So they got a $3 million judgment. Well, I just simply tried to extrapolate from this the fundamental principle that society shouldn't have to take care of those children either.
Yeah.
And society does, both through policing, through failed education efforts, because you can't educate these kids beyond 7th or 8th grade, and behavior problems, and health problems, just, you know, subsistence, housing. Everywhere you look, society's got to give them handouts because they are so feckless they can't do it from themselves.
Well,
and they definitely cannot grab the big brass ring of the American dream. And yet, they will sit and watch color TV where the American dream gets showed over and over and over. They are going to be doomed to a life of frustration. They shouldn't watch that kind of TV. There's no point creating a miserable discontent inside people for something like that, which they can never even come close to achieving except through handouts. So I didn't try to hammer this point home, but that's where does the you follow the trail. I mean, where does it lead you? You can't give up on your logic because it leads you into an unpleasant swamp.
Well,
you have to say, there's a swamp there, get out.
To fight the tyrants, the people who are in charge in government, who are abusing all of us, no matter what our IQ level. I mean, if somebody has a high enough IQ that they realize that they're being, fucked over by the government, by the police, by the courts, and it's because we the people aren't doing a good enough job of watching them. I want to appeal to, you know, all people to have a common bond to go against these people who are treating us like such trash, no matter whether we're intelligent, rich, poor, whatever else. They're taking whatever they can from us. And, you know, for me, fighting back against these international banks and corporations is adverse possession. That's one way. Educating people about the law and getting people together, unify.
Oh, okay.
That's what I'm going to try to do.
Well, listen, I want to dovetail into what you said. I got it. Okay, I've heard you say the same thing about this twice. You may have said it three times and I missed it. But here's the point. I got this point that you want to get even with the bankers. And that's why you're promoting adverse possession. I promote it because it's a good way to get a place to live that doesn't hurt anybody and that doesn't do anything but help everybody.
Yeah.
Now listen, that means the international bankers, well, let's just say the banks who are either trustees for a so-called security or their mortgagees or their, you know, lender assignees, whatever these banks are that are litigants that try to foreclose, The point is, adverse possession helps them. Have you seen my adverse possession benefits letter?
I will look at it.
No, I'm gonna make sure you're gonna look at it, because I'm gonna give it to you right now. Hang on. Benefits of adverse possession.
All right.
Good. You just Google it.
Okay. Did you email it to me, or did you?
I'm gonna.
Okay.
O3. I'm going to go to Scribd, because I put it there. Here it is. Benefits of adverse possession in Scribd.
Okay.
Okay. Now, I'm going to put that there. Boom. That's one of these. I'm just going to send it to you right now. And what, you know, just go look at this, all right? So when you look at it, you're going to see that this ought to be sent to the lender as well, because you want the lender to support the adverse possession effort, because you're not going to take the house away from the guy. You're going to just do what the owner should have done. You're going to take care of it.
Yep.
And that is the point of that. When you see that letter, you're going to say, what I'm trying to do is put myself in everybody else's shoes. And I made this kind of a long list that of like 18 points as to why adverse possession benefits everybody. And because of this, these points, you should feel free to send this to the sheriff, to the owner of the house, to the, you know, include it to the tax collector, include it to the property appraiser. You know, send it to the owner and send it to the mortgage company, the one company that's foreclosing. So.
Okay, I got that here. I'll read that.
This might not be the letter. I had another. This is just an article about it. Okay.
Yeah.
Let me see if I can find another one.
Benefits of adverse possession. I have that one.
Proposed letter. Here's another one. Okay. Copy. Okay, here we go. Here's another one. Letter. Oh. See, by the way, what I do is I upload stuff to Scribd because Google indexes it immediately. If I want Google to publicize something, when people type in the search terms, I'll put it right on scribd.com and upload it to my blog, because I want Google to index this stuff. So, yeah, from adverse possessor to alleged rightful owner of adversely possessed realty. Subject, adverse possession of residential real property at your address. And in here, we talk about all the benefits. And I tell them, hey, you know what, I'm adverse possessing it. Don't be calling, accusing me of trespass. I'll leave whenever you want me to. But the point is, I'm in your property. And this also serves to put them on notice that you're in there. So the court cannot say, hey, you didn't notify the owner. He didn't know you were there. The court doesn't need to say this. It is none of their damn business. If the owner isn't paying attention to his property, it's not your obligation to tell him you're on it. If he goes out of the country for 3 years, he ought to hire a realtor to check in on his property and mow the grass and stuff. He probably does.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think when you start digging around, you're going to find all kinds of stuff. I guess I'm going to have to do this for you, aren't I?
No. I'll do some reading.
Before you post this stuff,
yeah,
let me go over it, because I'll make sure that it's got all the stuff in it you need to put in it.
Okay.
And I'm not trying to steal your thunder or take it away from you. I don't care about that.
It's your, I mean, you're the one that did the research on it. I'm the one who writes on op-ed and learns stuff from everybody I talk to, so.
Cool. So I'll help you before you publish it. Let me just email me what you're going to do, and I'll go through it and I'll tweak it if it seems necessary.
If you just had a conversation with me, if you want to email something for me to post on op-ed with this whole talk, I'll do that. You want to do that, and I'll wait till tomorrow.
Yes, I'll do it. Okay, I'll do that. That's what I'll do. Because that's what I was getting at. I was thinking, well, do you want to go research and look at this stuff yourself or not? Now, obviously, it's really no point for you to do it because I know what I'm doing. And I've done it so many times. I'm going to say links for AP interview.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
So I'm going to put all the links in there the readers need to know. I can tell you it's cool because I have uploaded a whole bunch of documents, well, a number of documents, to, including AmJur. There's a link to AmJur on ScriptD. It's the volume of American jurisprudence that deals with adverse possession.
Yeah.
There's no shortage of laws on this stuff. The Harvard Law Review from 1917 had a nice article on adverse possession, and I uploaded that to the adverse possession group, and anybody that joins that group can go in there and see all these archives. You know, you can read all the messages and look at some of the bickering that goes on. The reason that only I post to my lawmen group,
yeah,
is I don't want to put up with a bunch of bickering nonsense from patriot mythmongers and sourpusses. A lot of people, they want the limelight, and so, you know, if they want to argue with me, they demand to be able to argue in public. Screw that. I don't mind discussing things, but I'm not going to let somebody just hog the airwaves. We saw a clear example of that in William Crowley, the black guy who stood up in the meeting and basically condescended toward me with his attitude of who should be a leader and how the thing should be done, and then proceeded to say, hey, they come at me with guns, I got a gun.
And then they put that on ABC to paint everybody with that picture.
So anyway, I'm going to get off the line here and go do this, and I'll have it to you in, say, 15 or 20 minutes.
All right, if you need more time or if you want to sleep on it and get tomorrow morning, that's fine. It'll take me a while to...
Why don't we do it tomorrow morning, but I'm going to send you what I can, okay?
Okay, if you're ready tonight, I'll do it. It's going to take me a while to render the video. I'll put that up. It probably won't get viewed.
By the way,
yep.
What do you use to render your video?
Showbiz 2.
What I want to suggest, you find another tool. Because it's one thing that it isn't very high resolution. Although I know that Francis's camera did a very good job, you have to make it low res in order to get the whole thing on there in some time.
Yeah.
But the other thing is this. It's distorted. The stuff he did was some kind of 16:9 format, and yours was a 3:4 or 4:3 format. So your rendering machine is not doing it right. You need to select a 16:9 output format. Because that's what YouTube shows. And that's what the original camera was. Now, in rendering this, it doesn't matter because there's no video. But in rendering those other two videos you did that Francis sent you, they're distorted. It makes me look tall and skinny. I am skinny, and I'm not all that tall, but I am skinny. But it was kind of extreme.
Actually, with YouTube videos, I pay more attention to the audio. Sometimes there's nothing I can do about it, but it's the miking and the audio. And I believe that's from 2006, so I should make some money and upgrade to a newer system because they've come forward leaps and bounds.
Have you tried using anything like Cubase or one of those? Look, I have this thing called... VLC, Video Lens VLC, it's free, and it has a little converter built into it. I mean, there are all kinds of movie converters that you can output a format into MP4 or something like that, or to FLV, so you can take a video and output it into FLV of whatever the right format is. Now, I haven't had a whole lot of use, I haven't tried this much with this little program, but it'll sit there and crunch and crank until it's done, I guess, and produce an output. I honestly, it's from France, and I don't really trust it, but there are all kinds of tools for doing video conversion that do a professional job, and they preserve the proper format. That's what you need.
I'm going to do more in public access television stations where I have access to their cameras, and then they have real video editing decks on Macs. And that's the way to do it. I've done video on a Mac computer at the studio, and oh my God, that is, you put it up on TV. It's
Hey, have you ever used any of those tools for Adobe? Adobe has this video production software that is pretty awesome, but it's got such an arcane command structure that I can't figure out how to use it. I mean, I don't have the patience to read the book. If it isn't intuitively obvious, I throw it aside and don't ever bother with it, but it looks like a very powerful piece of software that you can do, you know, you can put. For that matter, why can't you just use Microsoft Movie, or do you only use a Mac?
I have a PC with XP on it, and I do use Windows Movie Maker, and I do use various programs depending on what I want to do. And for YouTube videos, you know, if I'm not making, you know, I'm not making money on it, so it's the quickest, easiest way to get it up on the internet.
Hey,
is this?
Listen, here's what it is: AVID Mux.
Yeah.
Just Google AVIDEMUX. It's a Unix tool for which there's a Linux version available. There's also a Windows version. It does really excellent work with movies or with videos. You should just check it out because it's free and it works well. I've used it a lot.
All right.
AVIDEMUX. Just check it out. It may not have the capabilities that you want, but I thought it was pretty cool. Anyway, I'm going to let you go and get on to this project, okay?
Sounds good, and it was I enjoyed very much talking with you, and I hope to do more.
Okay, Stephen. Talk to you later.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye.